Good day, friends. I'm Govindaswamy Nallur, the executive advisor for Forge Accelerator, which is based out of Coimbatore. Welcome to the session of Fundamentals of Design, focused on product design. This is a part of online massive training session that's organized for the Smart India Hackathon. Without much ado, let's go to the presentation. Here's the agenda, what we will be talking about today. We'll start talking about the whys and the whats, product design perspective and value proposition, product design flow and process, product life cycle, and finally, wrap up. My dear friends, let's take a look at the photograph. What does this photograph tell us? From expectation perspective, if you consider two sides of the bridges that are not meeting, if one happens to be a manufacturer and the other happens to be a customer, it looks to me like, you know, the customer wanted something else, the manufacturer delivered him something else. It also tells us probably some of the processes that were not really followed, some of the checks and balances during your development cycle were not followed. If we had followed some of these things, probably we would have not ended up in this situation. Here's the next foil that I'm trying to communicate, basically how different people perceive the product development. So looking at this picture, what do we dream of at the time of kickoff? We all as engineers are wired to think some specific way. And we all think that, you know, we want to design what is best in the world. Somebody would have not designed, somebody would have not delivered, right? And we kick off. Once we kick off, we go through the whole development cycle. We get to the point that we are able to launch. What do we end up with? Probably a lot of features that we will not be able to implement, or that we think it's redundant, or some of them could be technologically not possible to implement at this point of time. Finally, what is the actual customer or user is looking for? You know, looking at the leftmost picture to the rightmost picture, you see that there's a huge gap. Why did this happen? Why are we in this situation? To me, this looks like few of the steps were missed as part of the overall product development cycle. And this is exactly what we will be talking for a period of next 1 hour. So, what is product design? Product design deals with three main aspects, right? The first one is what we refer to as the appearance, which is basically the physical form of the product. It basically talks about how the product looks, what the expectation of the market, or what the expectation of the user, right? The next one is basically the function, which is basically associated with how it is going to solve a user's problem. How does it help the user or the customer solving his or her problem? This is what we talk about when we say function, which is related to a product. The third one is the feel. What do we mean by the feel? It's basically the user's connect with the product. Some people refer this to as the emotional connect. Some people basically refer to as, you know, how you are creating a requirement or how you are creating a want within the user to go have this product. This is what we refer to as feed, or the users connect with the product. Before we get into a lot of the explanation on the topic of product design, I would really like to share with you three of the quotes that, you know, set the tone for this presentation. Charles Ames, basically said that the details are not the details. They make the design. I think it's a very profound statement. Right? You're not creating details just for the sake of creating the details. What he's specifically saying is, if you want to make a design, you should have some details and you should follow the details to go make that product. That detail should contain how you go make that product. Another one of the quotes that I really liked was from Stephen Ray. Products solve problems. Thoughtfully designed product improve lives. Now this is much more profound. The reason is anybody can design a product, but when you are designing a product, giving a lot of thought, a lot of analysis, a lot of thinking into the product, you are basically coming up with a product that is not just solving problems, but it is also impacting or improving the lives of the people or the customers who are basically using the product. Now, Steve Jobs, one of the most popular person, he very specifically says that you got to start with the customer experience and then you have to work back towards the technology, not the other way around. To me, this is yet another profound statement. Steve Jobs, known for his ability to basically come up with products that could create what the Stephen Ray basically mentioned and also what Charles referred to in his quote. Okay? One of the two things that product design address, I basically look at this as part of two perspectives that product design brings to the table. There is always a customer, there is always a manufacturer. Let's look at both the aspects to understand what product design means or should mean to each one of them. If you are a customer, at the broad level, product works as designed. That's the question he or she is going to ask. Does it do what I expect this product to do? Does it behave like what I expect this to behave? What's the user experience? User experience is a very big umbrella under which, you know, there are quite a bit of few things that you can list, like, you know, the usage, the touch and feel, whole lot of things. But end of the day, when you're looking at it, the user experience is what the customer is going to gain out of using the product. The next one is cost versus value. If you're asking a customer to pay X amount of dollars or rupees, the customer is going to go back and look at it and see, okay, I'm paying this much. Is this the value that I'm getting back for spending X amount of money? If the customer is not able to find out or understand or basically experience the value for the cost that he is paying for a product, then it is not satisfying him. And finally, we also talk about connection. What is the connection? The classic example today, when Apple introduced the iPod, it was not that there were no iPods in the world. There were a lot of iPods. However, what Apple did was the want. They created the want. The product basically has a fantastic finish. The features were fantastic. It could do a lot of things. Even though the basic requirement was basically playing music. However, Apple was basically able to create that kind of a connection with the user. And that's what the customers are looking at. Are they connected to the product before they basically go spend their money on it? Now, looking at it from a manufacturer's perspective, manufacturer will always go back and look at it. How can I design this product? How can I manufacture this product? And even from manufacturing perspective, how can I manufacture this product at scale? Right? And how can I build this product? Can I use standard components? Can I use standard processes? because end of the day, as we go through the presentation today, we'll be talking about it. Using standard components and standard processes gives you the advantage of cost. And the next one is basically the manufacturing cost. What is manufacturing cost? You have to design, you have to build, you have to test the product, and you also have to ship the product. There is specific amount of cost involved in each one of these functions, and they all add up end of the day for the manufacturer to go there and look at as to what is the manufacturing cost of this product and can I consistently manufacture this product. The next one is time to market. What is time to market? Time to market is in a market where there are competitors, where you know there are going to be competitors who are actually or probably developing products that are probably very similar to you or very close to what your product is doing. Now, if you are able to meet the market requirement much earlier than your customer, than your competitors, then you have basically got a head start compared to your competitors. You are ahead of the curve compared to the competitors. Now, the final one that I always look into is also that, what is the capability of the team? What do you mean by team capability? Team capability is basically that you have come together as a small startup or a small group of people, like-minded people who want to basically go get this product out, design this, manufacture this, and get it to the market. Now, while you go through the process of building the product, you will require different sets of skills. Some of the skills you could basically get from an external market. However, there are going to be few skills that needs to be part of your own organization or the company that you're building. The reason is these are referred to as core competencies. The core competencies are very important for an organization that is coming up, because that's going to differentiate how you do certain things that your competitors cannot copy. We will cover some of those as we go through the presentation. The next while I would really like to talk about, what's the value proposition? You can come back and ask me, yes, Govind, you're talking about product design, all those things, that's fine. What's the value proposition if I am basically following some of the processes of product design? Or if product design is considered to be one of the fulcrum in overall product development and marketing and manufacturing, all this put together. What does the product design basically bring to the table? There are three things that we look at. One is basically cost. This is cost of design, development, and manufacturing. Time to market, and the third one is quality. Each one of them has a specific impact on the overall product design and how the product is delivered to the customer and what is the response of the customer to the product that you deliver. Let's look at cost. Now, it's always a perennial pressure that for a manufacturer he would like to keep the cost of the product lowest for him to manufacture so that he or she could basically sell the product in the market to a much higher margin. Now, the cost of the product could be reduced in multiple ways. Product design has enough ways to basically give you the options of going back and reducing the cost of your production. However, you could spend a whole lot of time trying to basically get the cost out of your product. Everything comes with a price. Similarly, time to market. What is time to market? As we discussed, time to market is basically the time that you take in terms of how quickly you can get a product to the market before your competitors can come back with their product release. You are ahead of the curve. Now, if you are in an eternal cycle of trying to go back and reduce the cost, you will be spending a lot of time trying to basically reduce the cost, which end of the day is going to affect your time to market. Now, on the other end of the spectrum is the quality. Quality will need a lot of efforts, a lot of cycles to basically make sure that you are releasing a product that is of utmost quality. It also comes with at the expense of time. Now, if you look at all these three things, for you as a startup, to be releasing a product that is designed, you will have to go through the analysis of how each one of these basically affect the product design capabilities, product design timeline, and end of the day, when the market is ready to take the product, are you there with the product? So, in a nutshell, cost, time to market, and quality needs to be evaluated, one, in terms of which market vertical you are in sometimes. For example, a healthcare, you don't want to be going into a healthcare with a product that enters into the healthcare segment with quality that is lower. You don't have a second choice in the healthcare business. Probably a consumer market could have an option wherein you could release a product that is slightly higher in cost, but your quality is not 100%, but you're on the process to basically reach the quality of 100%. And you also need to be, in terms of time to market where you are, you could probably take that call. So, end of the day, if you want to basically go back and implement this, it requires multiple teams. And you also need to understand in terms of duration versus complexity versus now time to market, how you are basically going back and addressing. Here's a typical product design flow. This is not something that I would say that, you know, this is how everybody does the product design. There could be multiple variations to the product design flow. However, I would like to basically take this as a typical flow and go through this. The first thing on the line is basically the IDR concept. This way is where you basically go back and look at it and say that, okay, what's the idea or what's the problem statement you have today? Is there one problem or is it a multiple problem that you are trying to go back and solve? How does this idea help the customer? Is there a market requirement or is the market ready for somebody to come back and solve this problem? Or it could also be that there is already a product in the market and you see that the market is actually not, that particular product in the market is actually not solving the problem, or there are deficiencies within the features of the product, or there are challenges in the way how the product could be used by a customer. You could go back and come back with an idea to improve significantly the product that's already there in the market, and you could be a competitor to the product. The next one is need versus want. What do you mean by need versus want? Now, there's a set of people who always think that, yes, I would like to go back and design something like this. However, we also need to go back and understand, is this something that I want to go design as a product versus is there going to be a market for this product? Do we really want to sit down and solve this problem? Or which one we need to solve? If you have multiple problems, you basically look at the problems and say that, do I need to solve this problem? Do I need to solve the second problem? Or end of the day, I solve problem number one and we can probably bin the problem two and problem three for next release or next feature release or whatever it's going to be. On top of all these things, you need to ask yourself as a startup, ask this question. Is there a financial gain for me by going back and solving this problem, coming up with a solution? Can I do all these things? The third one is defining the solution. When we say defining the solution, you go back and look at it, you find that you have a solution. You need to think through and find out is there a unique solution that you have come up with? How unique is this solution as compared against the competition? You can always assume that there are always going to be 10 people who are probably thinking about the same problem that you are thinking and could probably be almost thinking about the similar kind of solution. So, if everybody is coming with that solution, how do you stay ahead of the curve? Is your unique solution is going to get you that edge in with your competition? Proof of concept. What's proof of concept? You have an idea and you have a solution. How do you know that solution really works? You need to validate that solution or validate the idea that this particular solution could be validated with some kind of a gadget that I am building. Now, the proof of concept is a very quickly put together product or a system that can validate some of the idea. How much of the features or how much of the solution space that proof of concept validates depends on complexity of the problem, depends on complexity of the product that you're thinking of. You need to ask these questions. Also, while you have built the proof of concept and validated, it will also give you a hindsight in terms of what's probably going to be the cost of the product. What's the cost target? Right? Does it make sense for you as a businessman to basically look at it and say that, yes, I'm going to go build this product. This is what it's going to cost me. And there is a market requirement. The market probably is ready to pay me this much for this particular product. And also, you will also have to think during this timeline as to what's your time to market, how much time you have to basically go back and develop this product. Next one is basically building a solution. What do you mean by a solution? You have done your proof of concept. A lot of times, proof of concept validates probably about 60 to 70% of your idea. There's always going to be some amount of changes that you need to make, some amount of design changes that you have to make, feature changes that you have to make to basically go back and fully validate this to be a 100% validated design. So, you build a minimum viable prototype. A minimum viable prototype is basically a prototype that basically satisfies the minimum product features that you're going to design end of the day. Right? Now, while you're building the MVP, you will also have to answer yourself. Is this design that I'm building is scalable in manufacturing? What do we mean by scalable or scalability in manufacturing? Are you able to ramp? Are you able to handle all the issues that you will come up during the manufacturing of this product? How unique are the products? How unique the components within the product that you have used? Right? All those things basically needs to be addressed as part of your building the solution. Now, you also need to ask yourself the question, does it meet the user criteria? What's the user criteria? Is the user's expected set of features or what kind of problems that the user is into? Does your product go solve that? And cost, definitely, because user is going to go back and look at, okay, what's the cost that I'm going to get this? And he's going to look at the value as we discussed early on. And your targets. What's your target? How much is going to cost for you to go develop this product and you still make money out of this? All these things will be evaluated as part of your build the solution timeline. Next, you get to what is called as the validation. This is probably one of the key things that everybody needs to be aware of, because the validation of features to find out how your product behaves. Does it behave as designed? Does the product operate as per the user requirements or the market requirements? Right? A user would have a set of requirements, whereas the market, which is much more bigger than a one single specific user, could have a much more bigger set of requirements. It could be a the user could be subset of a bigger set of requirements. So you need to be aware as a manufacturer in terms of how you validate your product. Compliance or regulations play an important role. A lot of times it has implications on how you architect your product, how you design your product, how you validate your product. Because, for example, if you take a product that is going into a healthcare, a lot of time compliance becomes the most critical part, compliance of the regulation system becomes the most critical part, because it has a lot of time that is required to go through the overall qualification. Manufacturer. Why are we talking about manufacturer here? Now, till this point, you have been building the product as part of the product design cycle. You have gone through idea to need versus response, to define solution, to build solution, and you have validated. Now you get to the point of actually, you have qualified yourself, you have convinced yourself, you have convinced few of your initial customers that, yes, we have a viable product that works perfectly. Now you need to scale up the kind of numbers that you want to hit, actually. Right? So if your product marketing is asking for 10,000 numbers for a period of 2 months, how are you going to basically scale up your design? Is your design scalable? So you start working with the manufacturers who can do this in bulk. Since this is done in bulk, there's a lot of automation that is required. Right? That's what we talk about in terms of manufacturing scale. Once you get through the manufacturing, you get to the launch. You launch the product. Now, are you done? Product design actually tells you you're not done the moment you launch the product. You also have to do one more very critical thing. That is basically, once the launch is done, you go back, track the product for performance, you track the product for quality, or what we call as the field quality. Why do we need that? There's a specific reason. We will talk about it as we get to in our next few files. We will now move into the next part of the product design process, wherein we will go in depth into how this whole product design process flow goes through. I have split the product design process flow into four phases. It's not that it will be always only these four phases. Somebody else could have this split into five phases. It all depends upon at the time when you are looking through a product very specifically, what phases might meet the criteria. That said, we will go forward now into each one of these phases. We will now cover the product design phase one, which has few of the items that we are going to cover. Some of it will have the continuity from the previous product design flow that we basically talked about. Clearly, at the top of the line is basically the idea or the problem, as we earlier talked about. In this phase, you have to spend more time trying to figure out what is the idea is about, how better you can articulate the idea that you are trying to think about, or a problem that you are trying to go back and solve. How are you able to define the problem, what we call as the problem definition? Unless the problem definition is perfect, you will not be able to basically find out the solutions for the problem. As there is always a saying, defining a problem takes 80% of the time. Rest 20% of the time basically is spent in solving the problem. Because unless the problem is perfectly defined, it is really tough to basically go back and find a solution. There's also one more very important aspect. If you are part of the team, or if you have 3, 4, 5 members are part of the startup, it is extremely, extremely important to make sure that each one of the members understand 100% exactly this the problem, and they are all in agreement as to this is what is the problem. Unless everybody in the team agrees that this is the problem that we are going to go after, it is going to be really a difficult problem down the line. Now, once you have defined your problem, once you have passed that stage of definition of the problem, now you need to basically go back and figure out, whatever I have defined as the problem, how does it matter to a customer? How does it matter to an industry segment? Now, this problem, if you have your own idea, it's a different situation. If you are given with a problem, it's a different situation. If you are given with a problem, when I say given with a problem, an industry can come back and tell you, here's my problem, here's the problem that I'm facing, I would like somebody to come back and solve the problem for me, right? So that is basically a problem statement or a problem definition done by an industry. Now, it comes with a problem statement. You will have to spend some time to basically understand through and make sure that you have understood the nuances of the problem so that you can define what the solution is. Now, if you have an idea, you come up, okay, this is what is the idea and this is what is the problem statement that I see there and this is what I think is the problem. Now, we might be in a situation wherein you think that this is what is the problem. However, there could be potential situations wherein you might want to go back and get this validated talking to a few customers. Unless we get through this process of trying to go back and define all the connecting dots and arrive at a situation wherein you have a perfect problem definition and understanding of the problem within the team, you shouldn't move forward. Because you want, end of the day, you want your whole team to be moving towards solving a common goal. The next one as part of the phase one I would like to talk about is evaluation. What is evaluation? It's evaluation about the problem itself. Now, you think that somebody gives you a problem or you see that there is a problem or an idea that you think you want to go back and solve. Now, at the top, you could see that there is only one problem. However, as you start thinking more and analyzing it, you feel that there are multiple problems associated with it, right? That one particular problem, what you see, could be the one that's in the front. But the moment you think that you have a solution to it or you have thought through that first problem, the right behind that, there could be multiple problems. Now, this could be true in cases, this could be false in cases, which is fine. I don't think that should inhibit you from doing this exercise. However, it's always advisable not to be sidetracked when you are faced with an idea of seeing multiple problems, because it's very simple. If you see multiple problems listed and you as a startup is trying to basically go back and solve the problem, it is very natural that you look at the problem and says, oh, you know what, I can solve this problem, I can also solve this problem, I can also solve this problem, and you start thinking about increasing the depth of your solution, or sorry, the width of your solution, which basically means that end of the day, now you have to timeshare your resources, your money, everything to basically go back and solve all these problems. It is advisable to make sure that you pick the right problem, you go after that one problem, you solve that problem first. Any multiple problems that are behind that, you could always take it up as part of your next generation or a next release solution, right? It need not be done everything in one single shot, because you also need to understand what are the risks that you will face as you are going through solving this problem. The next one is basically, how do you validate your assumptions? What are assumptions? When you are looking at a problem, you will not have 100% of your data. You will think that, okay, this is what could be the solution to the problem, or this could be what it is, right? Now, you need to validate some of that thought process, some of that information that you are trying to get yourself through, to make sure that you have gone through all possible potential questions as well as answers. And while you are getting the initial set of questions answered to yourself, you would have made some assumptions. Now, those assumptions need to be validated, saying that, you know, is it okay for me to assume that this is what it's going to cost? Yes, ballpark, that could probably be correct. However, how do you validate that? Yes, if you go to the internet, you could go find what is the cost of that solution. Or if this is not listed on the internet, you could always go back and find an industry veteran or an industry mentor who will be helpful to get you those, some of those assumptions qualified, right? So you need to make sure that you spend some time, you validate your assumptions, you also validate in with respect to some of the use cases that you are doing. Once you validate this, you also need to understand what are the market requirements. Now you got all your questions, you got all your assumptions lined up. Now you think that, okay, you got everything. You also need to understand what are the market requirements. Without knowing what the market requirements are, as part of your fact finding, you also need to find out if you are going to go ahead and bring up a product into the market that's going to solve a problem, do you think customers would be interested to go buy it? Now, this is not something like a full-blown marketing exercise. You go pick and choose few people who you think could provide you with valuable inputs. Take those inputs and make sure that you compare it with along with your assumptions so that you know you have your whole story at least right. Now, not every question is going to be answered in true faith. Not every question is going to have an answer. However, at least you should make a very good effort to basically go back and clear most of those doubts. You could use experts or mentors. You pick and choose as to who probably is going to be your right mentor or a right expert to give you those inputs. End of the day, it is you who will make the decision to take those inputs. Benchmarking. What is benchmarking? Now, as you thought through the problem, there are going to be multiple people who will also be thinking through these problems. And they will also probably sitting down and looking at it and also trying to make sure that they also come back with a set of solutions. Now, you have a competition. There is also one more sidetrack to this is, there is already a product in the market which you think is not doing what it is supposed to be doing, or there are probably potential drawbacks to the product from a user perspective, usage perspective, as a user experience perspective, could be anything. Now, you are trying to come back with a product that's basically go back and answer all those things and does the job much better than what the product is doing. Now, there is a competitor in the market, or there could be multiple competitors in the market. Now, you need to go back and benchmark yourself when you are thinking through your problems, your solutions, what your product is going to go do. You are basically sitting down and trying to compare your product against everybody else, because this benchmarking against the competition will provide you inputs in terms of what is the feature list that you will have to probably implement in your product. How are you going to basically get that distinctive advantage, right? It could be first mover, or if you're truly in a cost play situation, you need to really think through that. Or if you have a specific intellectual property that you have developed that it can uniquely solve this problem, yes, you have got a heads up as compared against your competition. However, all these things, it should be done as an exercise for you to convince yourself that this product, what the thing, idea that you are trying to go back and solve, what you're trying to basically bring to the market, will have all these things answered. Now, evaluate if this problem, whatever you are looking at, also has a technology solution and the market is ready for this. There are going to be times, and there is history to basically go back. If you go back and search on the internet, there are going to be few products that have been released way ahead of their time, wherein the market probably is not yet ready to basically take them. Now, there is also a situation wherein you have a fantastic idea in the mind. You think that that is probably the best thing that you can do. However, when you start digging deeper, you will figure out that, yes, there is a technology limitation. Now, you need to understand that if there is a technology limitation or if there is no technology limitation, however, people have not tried it because there is still some amount of validation in terms of the technology that needs to be done. You go do the technology feasibility analysis to make sure that yes, this is something that I can go back and build, consistently build, and I can validate to make sure that it consistently works. That's part of the feasibility analysis that you will have to probably go back and do this as part of this exercise. And then understand, if I'm going to go back and bring something which is technologically ahead of its curve, what is going to be the market readiness for the product as well? You have to spend some time to basically understand that. That is something that you think through as part of the product development flow. Now, come to the last one. What is it? You go through all this process, you go to spend all this time. End of the day, why are you trying to go back and do this? End of the day, you still want to basically go back and figure out whether you're going to make money or you're not going to make money on this product that you're trying to design, develop, and bring it to the market. It could be either case. It could be a service, it could be a full product, it could be probably a pure software product, it doesn't matter. End of the day, you need to make sure that going through all this pain of, you know, doing the analysis, looking at the solution, trying to go build the product, everything, you need to understand, will you be able to make the money? Yes, it might not be possible in the first 6 months, 1 year, depending upon what kind of product you are running, but the end goal should also be that you should be able to make money and show that there is, from business perspective, there's a business case that you can build on this product. Otherwise, this effort is going to be probably a costed effort for you if you're purely looking at it from an experience perspective. Moving on to the second phase, part of the overall product design process, we talk about potential solution. Now, how do you define a potential solution? You think that there's probably going to be one solution. There could be multiple solutions to the same problem that we are trying to solve. You always should make sure that we spend enough time to go figure out if there are any potential multiple solutions for the same problem. And you have to analyze each one of these solutions to go figure out, is there a cost advantage? Is there a resource advantage? Is there a time to market advantage? Or is there a quality related advantage? Or is there a technology advantage? There could be multiple of these reasons that could probably tell you how each one of these solutions is going to play out. You have to spend some time to go figure out each one of the solution, how does it relate to in terms of solving the problem, how the customer experience is going to be, and how you as a manufacturer of this product will basically achieve that in terms of cost, quality, as well as time to market. This is a very important exercise wherein you have to go through the process of trying to figure out multiple solutions. Once you have figured out what is your best solution out of the multiple solutions, or there are going to be situations wherein there's going to be only one solution. Once you have found out what is your best solution, now you build what we call as a proof of concept. What is proof of concept? As the name itself suggests, you had a concept or an idea or a problem, you thought through everything, you collected all the data, everything, and then you thought through a solution. You went through multiple solutions to figure out, this is the best possible solution for my product to go realize this. Now, you've done that part. Now, how do you know all the solution, whatever you have talked, is on paper or a whiteboard or in the air? You need to make sure yourself that whatever the thought process you and your team are going through, you have to validate it by building a quick and dirty proof of concept. Why do I say quick and dirty? Yes, you build a proof of concept based on off-the-shelf, easily available parts. For example, if you are building a air quality measurement device, let's assume that. I'm just taking an example. I could have taken any other example. This is just as an example. If we take If you take that, you are going to build an air quality measurement device, what you would like to see? You would definitely need some sensors, which are basically the critical part of how we are basically going back and measuring the sensor for finding out what is the quality of the air, quality, you know, dust in the air, carbon monoxide in the air, and all those things. Now, once you collect all the data, you should be able to basically pull all those data in together by some sort of an intelligence, which probably could be a microcontroller or a microprocessor, based on what kind of activity you want to do with this. Then you need to power this. You think about how do you power this, right? Now you put all these things together, and you have to write some amount of software to basically go back, you know, get your microprocessor up and running, and you have to basically go back and get all your sensors to work, pull the data from the sensor, tabulate it, and provide it as an output or some kind of a communication to whoever you want to provide this information. Now, you could go realize all these things with the off-the-shelf component. You can go back and use the Arduino boards. You can go back and build with a small evaluation board from any microcontroller or a microprocessor manufacturing semiconductor vendor. You can build it. You can build all the sensors of the, buy the off-the-shelf sensors off the shelf, and you basically build the product, and you go test the proof of concept to make sure that your idea is moving in the right direction, right? Once you get through the proof of concept stage, you know that this is working. Now you also need to understand, if you are able to basically go back and build something, somebody else, off using the off-the-shelf components, somebody else could also go do it. Now you need to differentiate yourself as a startup, how unique your solution is going to be. You have to think through that. How unique is the solution? Am I doing a lot of the analytics? Am I pulling the data from multiple years from the back? Am I doing some kind of an analysis based on the data that I am pulling? Am I doing some kind of an analysis to predict something? Can I do some predictive modeling? What is it? How are you basically creating that competitive advantage compared against your competitors, who else probably could also be thinking about this problem? So it's very important in the market to basically make sure that how you find your competitive advantage and uniqueness of your solution. It is extremely important to do this, because that is what is going to differentiate your product from rest of the products that are being developed, right? And being that you provide a unique competitive solution, and you are basically increasing what we call as the barrier of entry. How do you achieve all these things? These are the things that you achieve by finding out a solution, finding out a design. Your product should be able to basically go back and do all these things, right? The next one we talk about as part of the phase two is core competency. What is core competency? When you are building up your team, when you are building up your startup, or when you are building up your small company to basically design a product, you always find 2, 3, 4 core group of people. Now, these core group of people are basically your founders as well, most of the times. Now, the idea here is, once you bring in this team, you build team probably 5, 10, depending upon size of the company, what the kind of complexity of the product you're doing. You have your design, you have your solution, you've done all these things. Now, you need to go back and look at it and say, what are the things for this particular product design I am going to go do inside my own company? Keep in mind, we all understand, as you are a budding startup or building up a new startup, there's always the question of money. You are limited by financial resources. Since you are limited by the financial resources, you always want to keep your expenses and your operation costs lower, which means the number of people you can hire, the number of people you can maintain on your payroll is always going to be limited. One. Two, since you are a startup, you're always worried about your intellectual property within the team or within your company. So you would really don't want to go back and hire somebody that you don't know of. Which means now you look at how much of work you have and you decide, I'm having this much amount of work. How am I going to basically keep some of the core work that is very pertinent to this whole product development that I'm doing inside my own company and what I am basically going to go out and keep it outside and get it done actually, right? So which means you pick, you have to pick as part of the organization, as part of your core team, figure out these are the core areas or the core competencies that we have or we will develop also as well very quickly so that we do all these things as part of our own internal to the company. Rest of the things we can give it outside because we feel that there's not much that we are going to go lose if somebody is going to copy it, or this is just run of the mill stuff. Right? Next one is basically alternatives. What is alternatives? Now, you have looked at multiple problems and you thought that, okay, you know, you have multiple problems are there and there are multiple solutions also. Now, while you're doing all these alternate solutions, you're looking at all these things, the alternative study should also help you at this point of time because you would have done your proof of concept. You think that, okay, from the time I thought about this as solution to what I have done today as a proof of concept, yes, now I see there is a difference. My understanding was probably slightly different. Now I am in a situation where I feel the differences are significant so that, you know, now I need to go back and think about an alternative solution. Now, or there could be multiple alternative solutions for you. You think through that and you can go back and test some of those things on your proof of concept. That's the reason you build a proof of concept, right? And so that you could go back and test few of the things, few of the alternatives that could be as a potential solution for this problem. Finally, you also look at, you know, how is the cost, right? This is one of the key criteria as a startup. Now, you have built your proof of concept, you know to an extent about 70% how this product is going to be built, what are the key requirements of your product, you know what you have used to basically go build the product. Essentially, you cannot ship a proof of concept as a product. You will have to get it to a stage wherein, you know, you build it very specifically and you do all the modification, you do all the validation, you do all the qualification. However, the proof of concept gives you an opportunity to go back and relook at your cost. It will also give you an idea about what is going to be my development cost, because proof of concept, as we mentioned, is a quick hack. You're not spending way too much of time. You're not spending way too much of time on process, following this process, following that process. No, you're not doing that. All you're trying to do is basically, when you're building a proof of concept, is basically trying to develop a quick hack of a product that something closely resembles to your final product. It's a platform wherein you can go back and test a lot of things. What ifs, all these things could be covered there. So which means it gives you an idea in terms of what is the cost going to be, what is the cost of development is going to be. So that gives you your overall cost of the product from which you can decide as to how you want to continue this product. Is it worthwhile for you to basically continue development of this product and still make money end of the day? One of the last things that we also need to really talk about is time to market. What is time to market? Is basically how much time you're going to basically take from the time you start developing the product, when you will be able to start readily shipping to the customers. Right? There is definite amount of time that's going to be taken. Why? Because the reason is very simple. You have to go through a few of the stages as part of the product development that will have its own time that is required. You cannot rush through that. There are options to rush through them. However, you will have to be very careful about in terms of understanding the risks to rush through some of those. Also, please keep in mind, after you have done your proof of concept and you are ready to basically get to the next level, now you are entering the realm of product design that is designed towards making a product multiple number of times without losing any single product from, you know, in terms of not working, right? It is basically designed keeping a lot of times in how this is going to scale up in the manufacturing, right? Okay, So we get to the next phase of the product design process, wherein we start talking about how do you go realize this. Now, you have your solution, you have tested your proof of concept, everything. Now you know, you've gone back, tested few what-if scenarios, right? What are what-if scenarios? As I mentioned, there could be multiple different solutions you want to try, and you find that, okay, on this proof of concept, I have figured out that this is probably the best solution, this is probably going to be the best architecture, or this is probably going to be the best design. Now, once you have the design in place, you start writing it down on a piece of paper, you sketch everything, you find out what is this intelligence that I'm going to put in, what is the subsystems that I'm going to put in, how my whole system is going to be broken down into, for example, again, going back to the same example that I took of an air quality measurement. Instead of saying I have a full product, now you will basically sit down and say that, okay, I'm going to need a microprocessor which will need this kind of performance, or a microcontroller this needs this kind of performance, this should probably be within this target of cost, then I need this kind of sensors, and you know, how does these sensors work? For example, you're talking about this example that we are talking about, we are thinking about designing or developing a product as an air quality measurement. Where does this get installed? It gets installed outside. It's not working in your lab, nor it's working probably most of the times in your house. If you are basically designing the product to be designed and installed outside, that means you need to make sure that this has to work in summer, winter, as well as in rainy season, which means your box design, your outside box design has to be waterproof, and you should be able to take care of any of the water related issues. You should be able to take care of any corrosive element that is going to affect, or corrosive environment that's going to affect the working of your product, which means your selection of parts and components for this particular product will have to follow a specific guideline. Those are the things that basically you sit down and decide as part of the system and subsystems. Right? You are designing your overall system, split into multiple subsystems, and you are basically concentrating on, okay, how do I build this subsystem? How do I build this subsystem? How do I build this subsystem? Right? And for example, you are looking at also power supply. How do I power this? Is this battery power? Is this AC power? How do I do all these things? So those are the things that you basically do this as part of this one. One of the most important things that you need to be aware of during your subsystem and system design is the regulatory requirements or the compliance requirements. Keep in mind, this is one of the most complex things that is going to affect. If you don't play this game properly, or if you don't pay attention to some of these things very early on in your design phase, it's going to be extremely costly to go back and fix something down the line. It's extremely, extremely costly to go do this. So please keep in mind that you ask all these questions as part of that. Now, just to reiterate the fact, what are regulatory requirements? Giving an example, again, if you are designing something for a healthcare industry, the healthcare industry products, depending upon, you know, it is close to a patient or it's away from the patient, you will have different set of regulatory or compliance requirements that your product needs to go through, whether it's India or whether it's outside India, right? The healthcare requirements are very stringent, which means you have to make sure that you take care of some of these things in the design stage, you take care of some of these things in the validation stage, and once you are done with your product validation, you need to basically take this through the compliance testing to make sure that you get the compliance certification, because you are not allowed to sell without a compliance certification. You could do this as a field study. Even with field study, there is minimum requirement, compliance requirements that you will have to satisfy. Please plan through. The next one is basically the standard parts and processes. What are standard parts and processes? The standard parts and processes are basically those which let you build your system, build your system to a level wherein it's going to keep your cost down. If you are building parts, building your system with components that are basically available right out of semiconductor vendors, PCB vendors, system vendors, software vendors, that they don't need to go back and do a separate development for you, that means you are basically using a standard plan. Also, when you are building your system, if you are following the standard processes that is being followed by the industry, then your cost of building, for example, your enclosures, your cables, your lighting system, some of those things, yes, you will be able to control the cost. If anything that you require to be manufactured very specifically for you as a product, then you will have to pay a higher price. Keep in mind, there is something that takes this back all the way to how do you keep your product to be a very different product, or how do you differentiate, or how do you achieve differentiation from your competition. This is one way of basically achieving that differentiation. If you have found out something which is an intellectual property per se that needs to be implemented as part of your product solution, you will have to probably define and get this developed separately by some vendors. However, even though you are paying more cost or more money to basically get this done, however, what you are achieving is basically the one step ahead of your competition. You are differentiating yourself from the competition. That's what this brings to the table. So you need to be extremely aware of how this plays in as part of your overall design process. Enclosures and packing. Why are we talking about enclosures and packing? If you are in a consumer industry, if you are basically in the hospitality industry, or if you are in the healthcare industry, packaging plays a very important role. Packaging plays an important role to make sure that if something gets shipped out from you to a customer, it reaches the customer in a form and fit that is basically, it should be, you plug in, it should work. A lot of times we have seen people might have ordered this over the internet, lot of stuff that you basically order and that gets shipped to you. Now, there's a lot of dismay sometimes that, you know, you open up the box, you find that, you know, if the particular product that you have got has got banged up or something has broken. Why? Because a lot of times, I'm not saying this is how it happens, but a lot of times, if you are not paying attention to your design of enclosures and packaging, there is always going to be potential situations where this shipping and handling vendor will not be very careful, irrespective of you have a fragile mark on the product. It's very simple. So, in order to make sure that your product gets to the customer in a format that is always going to be perfect, please make sure that you spend some time understanding what are the enclosures and packaging requirements for your product. How heavy is your product? Can you just get away with regular corrugated boxes, or do you need some kind of a foam to basically take the shot? This is all something that you need to go through, because keep in mind, some of these activities take longer time. Next thing we are going to talk about is what we call as the minimum viable prototype. What's a minimum viable prototype? You have now gone through all these activities of trying to validate your idea or validate your problem on a proof of concept, which is a quick hack. Now you are at a stage wherein, after going through all these testings, you have to build and put together a product version, which is what we call as the minimum viable prototype. You can use this minimum viable prototype to basically do all your hardware, software, all your software, the firmware, your application developments, all your feature development, everything. One. Two, also validate most of your assumptions, validate all the features that you think that your product should have. And once you have reached a stage wherein you have good confidence that you are basically able to test most of these features out, then you use this prototype also to do your further testing or further feedback or the validation as you go into the product development cycle. Now, the next one is the validation. What is the validation? You take your minimum viable prototype that you have built, as we discussed in the previous file. You take that, you do all your validation. Once you have good confidence, you take the minimum viable prototype and work with your few select customers. Why do you need few select customers? Because you need to make sure these customers do some amount of testing, validate your product, and also give you what is the most important thing, is basically the feedback in terms of how your product is working, how your product is able to solve the problems or the concept for which you designed the product, how it is able to go solve and address that market space. Right? And what you claim to be the feature set of the product, does the customer feel that that's what is right, or does it work perfectly according to his requirement or her requirement, right? These are very important for you when you are basically getting this feedback. And that's what the minimum viable prototype basically provides you as part of its your software, your application, your feature development. You do the validation, and you basically take it to the customer. Right? And that's what you basically get as part of the feedback and iterations that are basically coming back. Now, what is feedback? Feedback is what the customer comes back and tells you that, you know what, this is what really I like. Yes, you got all these five features, but you know what, to really make sense for you guys to basically go back and put two more of these features in, right? Or he would come back and say, you have provided all these features as part of this product. It's excellent, but, you know, I don't really like half of the features in this. Why? By the time, this could be that the market is slowly shifting its reach as well, right? Now, it's nothing wrong in what you have done. It's just that market is changing towards something else. So now you need to basically take some of those feedbacks, come back and see what it takes to basically go back and implement some of this and how to very quickly turn around. Keep in mind, it's also much easier now that you have a prototype that you can control a lot of the things. You should be able to quickly come back, make changes in the software, make changes in the application, if need be, make changes in your hardware itself, that will basically come out as a different product than what you initially thought out to be. Which is fine, this is part of the feedback iteration, right? And this is what the customer engagement model also talks about. We now get to the phase four of the product design process. Here, in this phase four, we'll be completing talking about some of the very critical aspects of the design and manufacturing process as part of the product design. There's a new word or the concept that I'm introducing is called as the DFMA. What is DFMA? DFMA is in short for Design for Manufacturing Assembly. As part of the product development, it is extremely critical and important for you to understand as part of a product owner or a product manufacturing company, to understand the nuances of how your design, how your product is, what you have designed as part of the product development, how it basically relates into what are the challenges that when you get into manufacturing scale, how it is going to be viewed by the manufacturer. And as a manufacturer, it is basically the next level of basically the assembly houses, the PCB manufacturing, the assembly of the board itself. All these activities we refer to as assembly process. A lot of times, a PCB is a bare PCB, and PCBA is what we refer to as the PCB assembly. Now, what is design for manufacturing and assembly? Design for manufacturing assembly is basically the process wherein, while you are going through your design process of the product, be it the external box, all the user interfaces like the switches, connectors, LEDs, all these things, air inlets, air vents, and when you get to the inside of the box in terms of, you know, the PCB, how it is mounted, how you are taking the thermal or the heat which is generated inside the box outside, all these things will have an impact in terms of how good your design is from the manufacturer perspective. It also talks about, you know, when you basically build the hardware, now you have all the components that go on the PCB, you have all the processes that go in, whether it is a surface mount process or you're basically using a through-hole process actually, right? And each one of them have their own pros and cons. Now, in order to make sure that your design is perfect in terms of the whole process, your design is perfect in terms of taking care of most of the PCB manufacturing, PCB assembly, and also the test, this whole concept of design for manufacturing assembly comes into picture. There are multiple smaller facets of DFMA. For example, there is something called DFMT, which is basically designed for manufacturing testing. What is it? Now, when you are manufacturing your product in scale, you definitely will not be in a position to basically take each one product and test it one by one, because you are end of the day delaying the whole process. So what has been done as part of the automation in the backend is basically to see how quickly you can do some of your testing. So there are processes that are defined for design for manufacturing, design for testing, design for assembly. As long as you are able to follow some of these processes, it would be very easy for your design to scale up in the manufacturing floor or the manufacturing house, as we refer to. This is also quite similar and same to if you have cables in your design, how the cable should be, how the cable routing should be, right? And how is your packaging basically take care of all these things. As we discussed the packaging earlier, we need to be careful that your packaging should also take into consideration if you are basically shipping external power supply devices, any cables that is going along with it, your documentation, everything needs to be packed as part of this. This whole thing basically comes in as part of your overall DFMA process. Now, as you go through the design for manufacturing and assembly, you get your first of the manufactured lot, you go through your what we call as the final validation. Why do we do the validation second time? The reason is very simple. When you are in an MVP, where we basically talked about minimum viable prototype, you have built your prototype, you have tested things, you have got some feedback from the field, you have gone back and implemented some of those things. If you are, for example, the air quality measurement example that we took earlier, if it is the product, you basically have gone back, tested this in the field, you found that during the rainy season there is some amount of water that's coming in, which means you need to basically go back, make sure that, you know, your casing, whatever you have done as part of the work to basically make this product dry or waterproof, have they been fixed? Two, are there any regulatory or the compliance related measurements and qualifications that you need to, or certifications that you need to do in order to get the certification done for this, right? These are the things that you would have taken as a feedback. Now, as part of your final DFMA process and the prototype design or your final design that you are closing, you are going to take care of all these things. All these things are built together as your final board or final product. Now you go do the final feature testing, you do your performance testing, you also do your regulatory or the compliance testing to make sure that you get your confirmation. Invariably, it's a thumb rule that whenever you go for your government regulatory or the compliance testing, which could be telecom related, which could be healthcare related, which could be even defense related to an extent, you all need to make sure that as part of your product, you are giving them the final hardware or the final product along with the final shipping software, because they would really like to go back and find out. If you are, for example, a healthcare product, they would really like to find out what are the emissions that are coming out of your product. Is it within the range that is defined by the government? Is it within the range that is defined by the health authorities? As long as you are able to go measure and meet that criteria, then you are good to go. Hence the reason it's always prudent to basically have your final piece of hardware or final piece of product, as well as your final shipping software that is going to go along with it. Then you basically, once you are done with all these things, you are very confident that you have tested, you have validated, you got your compliance testing in the process and you are not seeing any issues, you release your design for bulk manufacturing. Bulk manufacturing is also referred to as scaling up in your manufacturing, where your numbers are much bigger than what you built for your minimal viable prototype, or even for that matter, the previous cycle, which was the manufacturing cycle. Now, is this always fixed in stone that you have to keep doing two iterations or three iterations? No. It's purely dependent on you as a company, how good you have been able to basically take care of all the design part of the work, all the product development part of the work, all your enclosures, your regulatory, your compliance, all these things. If you have an MVP that you have designed, has no problems, it works perfectly well, it passes all your regulatory, you don't need to basically go back and build any more extra prototypes. You are ready to go, except that you have to converse with your manufacturer to make sure that the product documentation or the design documentation that you are handing over to your manufacturer, the bill of material that you are handing over to the manufacturer is up to date, is in line with everything, is in line with the standards, and you basically release it to the manufacturer for bulk manufacture. Now, what comes after that? As you have been extremely patient to be waiting for this, you launch your product, right? You launch your product because that's what is your whole work that has taken you, depending upon how complex is your project, how long your project is running, anywhere from 9 months all the way to 1.5 years, 2 years, right? There's a lot of hardware work, there's a lot of software work that has gone, a lot of application work that has gone. This is the time wherein basically you look at it and say that, yes, we are basically ready to launch the product, you go ahead and launch the product. Now, the last thing in the phase four is something that I would really like to spend a few minutes. Once you launch your product, you know that you're shipping the product, you're slowly, the numbers are increasing. We will probably go back, we'll also, at the end of this presentation, closer to the end of the presentation, we'll talk about product lifecycle management as well, wherein we are going to refer to a few of these points here. However, what is important in this file is about you after releasing the product. Once it has started to gain sufficient numbers in the market, in the field, what we refer to as in the field, you will start seeing some failures. It is bound to happen. Any product is bound to fail. Now, you need to be looking at what these failure rates are. Do you see any trends in this? Because invariably, if you have a design problem, if you have a validation problem, if there is a component related problems, there are going to be some failures, and you can pick up the trends of the failure to connect the dots and say that, yes, we have a problem, you go back, fix it. One. Two, there could be potential situations wherein the product that you have released, customers might be using it for extremely different situation. There was a situation that I can understand and I can relate to. It was a long time back, about 15, 20 years back. All of a sudden, one of the brand name washing machine manufacturers started to see a spike in the request, spike in the washing machine sales in one specific part of India. Now, they were really trying to basically go understand why this was happening. It was extremely confusing for them because their marketing analysis, marketing channels, market analysis from the field, everything was not basically talking about any of this, nor they thought about this is what it's going to be. So they really wanted to understand what the situation was. When they started digging deeper, they realized this was basically the summer season, and one part of India where the temperature was very high, these washing machines, instead of basically doing washing, used for being washing cloth, these were basically used for making lassis in very large scale. So there were a huge number of washing machines that are being used to basically go make lassis. Now, there was nothing wrong with doing that. There was nothing wrong with the washing machine. It was just that the market data that was coming back to him. Now, the reason why I brought this up as a point is, now you realize that for your product, which you think it's going to be used as part of a use case study you have done and all those things, there could be a set of customers who would probably end up using your product in a very different segment. Now, it could be a direct fit, or at times it could be that you will have to probably go back and tweak certain features to make it 100% perfect to that fit. These are some of the things that you take back as feedback from the field, from the market, even after you have released your product. There is also the other thing. You remember when we started this presentation, we talked about different set of problems. Is there one problem, multiple problems? And we all came back and made the decision that yes, you know, in order to concentrate on getting the product out, time to market, keep the cost low, and quickly get something in the hands of the customer, we said yes, we know that there could be two or three problems. We're going to pick the most critical problem, we're going to solve the problem. Now it is the time basically for you to go back and look at, is the two problems that you left are still the problem? Is it still validated? Is there a market requirement? Customer would like to have it? Yes, go ahead and see how best you can go back and implement all these things. Right? This is what you do as part of the post your product launch. Okay, so the next two files, we're going to be talking about product development lifecycle. What we have talked till now is kind of life cycle flow and all those things. But in the next two files, I'll really be taking an example to walk you through how it works and also talk about a one single snapshot of, you know, how a product, overall product development lifecycle will look like. Now, this is, I've tried to basically make this as simple as possible. Let's walk through an example, right? As we have taken an example earlier in the program, let's continue to go with the program. So you are designing basically a air quality measuring product that's going to be installed outside. When I say outside, it's outside the house and the roads, everywhere, right? And you are basically providing connectivity in terms of an app that basically goes and pulls the data out, and you're going to go basically to your dashboard. Now, that's your product. You've gone through your analysis, problem analysis. You find that, yes, it is definitely required in some of the cities where the air pollution is pretty high. So this could make a very good market. So you basically take that, you build your POC, you validate with a bunch of sensors, and you find that, yes, using the POC, using an off-the-shelf Arduino board, you are able to basically hook up to all the sensors, you're able to pull all the data, you look that it makes all the sense, this is how I'm going to go design the board, this is how I'm going to go back and build the application and all those things. Now you go through your component selection, you basically say that, okay, this is the microcontroller that I'm going to use, these are the sensors, you look at it, because this is not an indoor product, this is also a product that is being sold outside, installed outside, and it has to work 24/7 outside. That means your component selection has to be very different. Why? Because your temperature or your operation temperature is no longer 0 to 40 degrees within a house. It is probably minus 15 degrees all the way up to plus 50, 55 degrees, right? You are looking at a pan-India market, which means the component selection that you are doing has to be made sure that you're picking the components, every single component in the design has to work through this temperature range. Now, when you get into that mode of designing, you will also have to basically go back and look at what is the support from the semicon vendors or the passive vendors, or if you're looking at some box design that's going to work, you need to make sure the material that you guys are all using is going to be within that range. Okay? You also talk about hardware and software partitioning. What do you mean by partitioning? You basically say these are the functionalities that 100% we will handle in the hardware. These are the functionalities that I will 100% handle in software, because there are certain times where you will not be able to, meet everything or build everything in the hardware. You will have to move some of the feature sets or some of the way you configure stuff. You will have to do it in the software. So those are the things that you design. In the high level design, you basically now basically take it, you go through making your schematics, you do all your designs in terms of, you know, logics, your power design, you're basically pulling all these individual components together, you're generating all your networks. Parallelly, you're basically going through your software development cycle or firmware development cycle, depending upon how much of software you are basically building on this product. You basically start doing all these things because you already have a spec, you know what your product at the hardware level will do. You start writing all your routines, all your use cases, your applications, everything. Right? Then you get to the physical design. What you do in physical design, you basically get into your physical layout, your PCB layout, right? And you are basically following, if I have to test this, what are test points I need to know. Right? What are the access points I need to know? How I am going to basically mount this PCB? Is it upside down? Or now, where are all my touch points to this product? What are touch points to the products? These are the ones which are basically your user access. These are the ports. These are the buttons. These are the LEDs. Right? All those things basically will be reviewed, will be made sure that you are adhering to all these things. If you are an external box, like what we are taking as an example, you have to work between the ranges, minus 20 degrees, all the way up to 55 degrees, right? Why? Because when you design a product, if your operating temperature range is basically minus 10 degrees to minus 45 degrees, minus 10 degrees all the way up to plus 50 degrees, you always build a margin in your design, which means you design your product to work between minus 20 degrees all the way to 55, 60 degrees. Why? Because the margin will provide you any component level or product level degradation, right? So you build all those things, what we refer to as well as mechanical and thermal design. That's where you do all this analysis. Now, once you're done with the physical design, you release it to prototype. Once you get your prototype, which is where basically you build the PCB, you do the PCB assembly, then you basically do all your design for manufacturability, design for test, all those things you basically cover as part of your prototype, and you basically take your feedbacks, you do all your some of your basic testing there, and then you basically do your validation. What you do in terms of your validation, you basically look at all your feature list, you look at what you think that your product should support, and you basically go back and make sure that you're testing all these things. All your compliance testing, all your regulatory level testing is basically completed as part of your overall validation activity. Keep in mind, the prototype and validation will not be one single cycle or one specific 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks cycle, right? Depending upon the complexity, depending upon the issues that you hit as part of your design, development and debug, your prototype could be split into two phases. You will do prototype one, you will do prototype two. Similarly, you will do validation one, you will do validation two. For the sake of basically showing the concept flow, I basically put this as one single flow here. Right? Once your validation and all those factors are complete, you now get to the next stage, which is basically you are ready to get into volume manufacturing, and you also basically release all your bill of material, your vendors, you know who you are and who your bulk vendors are, you work with them, you work on your costing, you work on, since you are going in bulk manufacturing and manufacturing, your cost of production reduces actually, right? So these are interrelated. What is MTBF? That is one another important concept for you. If you want to really understand how your product is behaving in the market, there is something called as a mean time between failure study. What is mean time between failure study? You basically take your bill of material and each component in your bill of material, as per the standards, the manufacturing vendor for that particular component would have come back and say, this is the operation range, and I guarantee that this particular component operates in this range. If you're operating within this range, this is going to work for 10 years, right? Each component will have that number. It's a statistical number. Now, you take all the whole of your bill of material, you compose it together, and you get at what we call as a mean time between failure, which is a predicted MTBF. Now, once you take the predicted MTBF, what it will give you is the number which will tell you when, after so many number of hours, this product is going to fail. This is no longer a component, because all the components inputs are taken together and there is a statistical analysis that is run to arrive at a number. Invariably, any product that you take will come with a mean time between failure number. Now, once all these things are taken care of, now you also need to plan for field service and sustaining, depending upon what type of market you are in. If you are in healthcare, if you are in industrial IoT, for example, right? Or for the same example that we are talking about today, if you are doing business with government, now it mandates that, you know, you need to have your field service and sustaining activities planned. How do you plan your activities? Right? How do you get your RMA? What is RMA? If there is any field failure, this is basically returned to the manufacturer or the dealer basically to get a replacement. Now, when you get all these RMAs back into your company, it provides you with valuable information. You need to basically go back and figure out what failed, why it is failing, is there a trend, how can I understand this whole trend so that you could go back and improve the quality of the product. Right? Come to the final foil in the whole product development discussion that we are having. I want to basically sign off this presentation with one single foil that basically talks about, you look at the picture on the left, which tells you the early stages of your product life cycle, and on the right side you have the later stages of your product life cycle. During your early stages of your product life cycle, where you are introducing the product is growing, there are going to be some features. There could be a lower demand, higher development work during this time. There is also going to be stabilizing the product features and performance. Why do we talk about this? Because this is a typical product life cycle. Now, this curve could vary. The height, the width could vary depending upon what market, what product you are doing. However, this gives you a gist of how the product life cycle is, right? So the left side basically talks about your development, your introduction, and how you are growing this product in the market. Now, once you reach a specific number of installations in the market and how your product is basically performing in the market, you hit what is a plateau, kind of a plateau called the maturity of the product. Your product is mature. What do you mean by product is mature? It is where you will see very minimal number of failures or feature requests, new feature requests or something. People are happy with what you have given them. Customers are buying them. You continue to sell those. After some time, you will slowly start seeing your orders are coming down. Why? Because the product seems to have hit the decline. That is basically your later stage of your product cycle. This is very normal for any product cycle, that you will start seeing a fall off from your maturity higher levels. Slowly it will start coming down, and which gets probably overtaken by a product that is much more better than that, or the market requirement would have completely changed, which is perfectly fine for any product for that matter, right? With this, we have come to the end of the presentation on the product design. I hope we have gone through all the process flows, how to go about doing the product design. We wish you all the best of luck. Thank you very much.